It's time to talk about the shape registration problem. In particular, we will deal with the problem under rigid transformations today. So basically, the rigid shapes are the ones that differ by rigid transformations, such as translation and rotation, as we see in this horse case, where some translation and rotation difference exist. There is also another shape registration department that deals with non-rigid shapes. It is more challenging, and we have dealt with that in detail in the deformation lecture. You can check that out in the previous videos. Basically, in non-rigid case, we have rigid transformations as well as bending, stretching, so those type of other transformations, and consequently it has a higher degree of freedom, which makes the problem hard to deal with. Here, in our case today, we will only be dealing with a low degree freedom consisting of rotation and translation. Main application of rigid shape registration is in 3D scanning, which is a very significant business because it's also a commercial thing. You can scan stuff for industry purposes, for entertainment purposes, etc. So basically, you will be able to scan one particular angle at a given time, so that's why you will do multiple scans, and there will be a way to merge all these scans, to align those scans, or to register those scans. So the term register comes from there, actually. Non-rigid shape registration has applications in other types of merging stuff, like the data you deal with may be coming from a motion capture, for instance, right? So only the markers are available to you, and with different poses than your initial reference pose, which is this robot. So you need to deform this pose into this marker-based point cloud, which has some missing information. So this is one particular application there. So let's talk about solutions. I can do principal component analysis to solve this problem for an easy scenario where the shapes are completely overlapping, okay? At different orientations, but they need to be complete. So what I say is, I will extract the principal components of this mesh, in other words, principal directions of variations. So here, this is the most significant variation direction. It is P1. So I will align P1 with x-axis here, P2 with y, and P3 with z. So I will do it for this pose as well as this pose. I will do it for this model as well as this model, and I will consequently align them. That is the idea. But to begin with, I first resolve the translation disambiguity by translating the centers to the origin. So it is easily done. It is not a big deal. Then the rotation part is the rotation disambiguation is about the PCA that I summarized before. Let's get into a little bit detail. Basically, to find these principal components, I need to perform principal components analysis on the covariance matrix. So this covariance matrix, it's a nice matrix. It encodes an indication of whether two attributes change together or change in opposite directions, or maybe not change at all. So in this case, my attributes are my x and y coordinates, also z coordinates, x, y, and z coordinates. So I will have a 3x3 covariance matrix. Basically, intuitively, what this computes is the variation of x from the mean of x times the current x point, the deviation of current x sample from the mean of the all x samples, times the deviation of the current y sample from the mean of the all y samples. So why does this compute this indication of whether two attributes change together? Let's think about this example. For this case, I am dealing with a point 1, 3. Okay, x is 1, y is 3. Basically, I know that mean x is 0 and mean y is 4, so this can be computed in advance, right? So for this current sample, x is above average, so it tends to grow, right? And y is below 4, y is below average, so it tends to decrease. So what I understand from this sample is when x is increasing, y is decreasing, so there is a negative covariance. And so this is for only one sample. You need to do it for all the samples, and that's why this summation kicks in. And then you compute this covariance matrix with that logic. Then the eigenvectors of this matrix will give me the principal directions. Why? I will show it again intuitively in the next slide, but now the eigenvectors of C provide the principal directions of variations. Wonderful. Then what I will do is I will align it with the xyz Cartesian coordinate axis for both cases, and the alignment is done. Now let's do more intuition. Why do the eigenvectors of C give the desired principal directions of variations? Because of that, so take any vector, for instance, this is minus 1, 1, right? Transform it with the covariance matrix, then you end up with this vector, okay? Then apply C to this vector again, then you end up with this vector. Apply C to this newly found vector, and you come to here again. So what I observe is multiplying by C spins the initial vector towards direction of the greatest variance. It is also scaled up a little bit or down, but it is okay. So for my purposes, I am about this turning. So look for the vectors that don't get turned when multiplied by C. Okay, then it would be because multiplying by C will turn it towards the greatest variation. Then if I look for the vectors that don't get turned at all, then I am already in that maximum variation direction, right? So this is where eigenvectors kicks in, because eigenvector of M is a vector. So I have an intuitive slide here. Eigenvector of a matrix M, this is the eigenvector, is a vector. When M is applied to this, direction stays the same, see? But scale may be different, and eigenvalue encodes that scale difference. It's not our topic now. So that is the intuitive definition of eigenvector. So basically, if I can find these eigenvectors for M that don't change direction after M is applied, then I am golden. So that's why I will be looking at the eigenvectors of C for the greatest variance. Okay. So I put some pop quiz style thing here just to improve your intuition on eigenvectors. So just consider this explanation. Eigenvector is a vector that has not changed direction. So if I am talking about a reflection matrix that reflects this vector around this line, so this vector is not an eigenvector of this reflection matrix because it is reflected like this. Its direction has changed. However, this vector that is perpendicular to the reflection line is an eigenvector because the direction is still the same multiplied by minus 1. Or another eigenvector is this, aligned with the reflection line. When I reflect it, I end up with the same vector. So the answer is 2 here. For a uniform scaling matrix, what it does is takes this vector and scales it up uniformly. It becomes like this. So just the definition. So all the vectors are eigenvectors then. What is this 2D rotation matrix? In 2D, I rotate everything around this z-axis. So every vector, once rotated, will have a new direction. So there is no eigenvector there. But with 3D, be careful. All the vectors are going to rotate around this axis of rotation. So then the axis of rotation does not rotate at all. There is only one eigenvector there. So that is the intuition. But now let's leave the algebra, come back to our business. Remember, what I need to do is I will align this principal axis, which I already know, with the Cartesian axis. So how to do that? So assume that this black one is the principal axis, and I will align it with the Cartesian y coordinate, y-axis. So intuitively, I will do the following. I will what will I do? I will first rotate this vector around z-axis, so it will snap onto zy plane, and then rotate it around the x-axis, so it will hit here. So I will need this z angle, and then I will need this x angle. So the way we compute them are straightforward. For the blue angle, basically, if you consider this diagonal, it is the this has x and y coordinates here, so they are just here projected exactly. So I have this xy length, which is by Pythagoras theorem. Then cosine of this angle alpha is basically y over x length. Therefore, I will take a cos of y over x length, xy length. That is how I compute the blue angle. And for the x angle, the dark angle, the procedure is the same. I have cosine of this dark angle is what? Xy length over vec length. And vec length I can compute by the length of this black thing. So I just do a cos on that. This is a cool approach, but it doesn't really solve the problem because it moves object from one position to another within a single reference frame. But I need to change the whole reference frame. So I can put it like this, consider a table. It has its own local coordinate system. I don't want one. So this local coordinate system is like maybe 0, 0, 0 is on the center of the table. But there's also a more world coordinate system that is far away. And according to that, the center is maybe at 10, 10, 11, whatever. So with that angle rotations, I will be updating the points on the local coordinate frame. But what I really need to do is I need to move all these local coordinate frame on top of this world coordinate frame. And to do that, there is a nice matrix that will solve my problem. Basically, u x, u y, u z are our principal components found by eigenvectors. So you just put them as rows, so as columns into this rotation matrix, and then apply it to our points. So now they align well with the xyz axis. So this is the solution that works for complete overlap. But when there is an incomplete overlap, there is a problem because this is a global approach. What I mean is the following. For this horse, D1 is this, right? Obviously, the most variation in this direction because most data happens to be on this horizontalish direction. In the second input, D1 is like this because this is a partial case and it happens due to the legs. Variation tends to be on this diagonalish frame. And when I align D1s together and all others, so let's align D1 with D1 here and D2 and D3 also aligned. So if you plug this, if you overlay them, you see that there's a terrible alignment. And this is because PCA is a global approach, but my inputs are just partially overlapped on some local regions. So I need to think about a different strategy. There are three strategies. If I know at least three perfectly corresponding points, then I can find the rotation in one shot. We will see. But it is not a realistic scenario. I never know because I scan in one direction and then other. There is no connection between these points. So this is the most popular algorithm when the map is unknown. It is also the mostly cited computer graphics paper in my to the best of my knowledge. I think it had about 18,000 citations as of 2020 in Google Scholar. There is an alternative called RANSAC, Random Sample Consensus. We will also see that. But regardless, remember our main motivation to align all these scans all together. So this is a pairwise algorithm, any of them. I have two shapes and I align one with other. But how about aligning all of them with other? You can pick an anchor scan, which is usually the one that has the highest surface coverage. Okay, you can find it. Then you align all to them. Or another alternative is greedy. You align each new scan. So these two is in my are in my hand. I align them. Then to this result, I align this one. Then this one. Then this one. But there is a problem. If there is some error here, it is just accumulated when I align the next one to the current one. I don't try to correct that error. And also this order dependent. What if these are my first two and then I begin like in this order? It changes the result. So there are issues to be considered there. But first, let's make this pairwise alignment perfectly clear because it is the heart of everything. So as I told you, if the map is known between, or the correspondence is known between green and red, again, this is an unrealistic assumption, but anyway, then you can find one rotation in one shot. So in this case, A goes A prime, B, B prime, so I can do it. I can find the optimal rotation with no error. But if the correspondences are not perfect, like this is the shape bigger, the prime shape is bigger, then should I put the small shape like towards the corner or right in the middle? So I need to minimize the energy, which is the sum of these differences between A and A prime, B and B prime, D and D prime, etc. So I need to minimize an error. And to cast this problem more formally, I will transform Pi towards Qi, assume Pi and Qi is in correspondence. So I will apply rotation and then translation. So I end up with a new point, transform Pi, and the difference of it from Qi should be as small as possible because I am minimizing. This is argmin, by the way, obviously. There is also this weight. It emphasizes, maybe you have some confidence that these two, Pi and Qi, this pair is a perfect match, and that Wi should be very high because then I really don't tolerate the difference between that Pi and Qi. But if I am not confident, I can keep this Vi very low, so it doesn't affect my overall energy function. Again, if correspondences were perfect, then this thing can be minimized in one shot by solving these equations. However, in general, correspondences will never be perfect. So actually, it is the idea of ICP. You assume closest point correspondences, find some transformation, apply it, then in the new configuration, then re-find the closest point correspondences. So this is the general theme that we will see. But again, I will first show you how to minimize this energy function in the least square sense. So it calls for taking the derivative of this function and setting it to zero. But why do we do that? Just a quick visual recap of derivative and derivative-based minimization here. Derivative, so I will give you a geometric intuition. You obviously know that this is the rate of change of something, but let's see this in action. So if I dip this elephant into a water, the volume of water will increase. The height will increase, right? It is the Archimedes' law. So it will increase. As I dip it more and more, it will increase a lot, and at some point it won't increase anymore. So what is the derivative of this function, the volume with respect to time? So it's, I will show you the rate of change in the water level, okay, water volume, how fast it's increasing. So if you look here at a particular time, so let's take this time, okay, at this time, lots of, so all the points in this horizontal line all the elephant points in this horizontal line will contribute to the level increase. And so it's a big increase because there are lots of points here. And in the immediate, the next line, still there is a big increase. So it's so this they correspond to this region. What I mean is that because the rate of change is quite a lot because I am dipping a lot of points at that time. However, at this time maybe, so let's take this time. So this time, this line doesn't hit any leg, right? It just hits the torso part. Then, okay, it is still increasing. So this is positive, okay? Derivative is positive. However, the rate of increase is not as much as the rate that I have first shown you. So that is the intuition. And also another intuition, there is no negative value here because the rate is always positive. I always increase the level. The level never goes decreases, right? It at worst stays the same. It is the intuition. So I think I am repeating that here. We increases at the same around here. Yeah, so see the derivative is kind of fixed here because this time and the immediate the next time I am talking about almost the same region, right? Torso and leg. So it is very high because I am dipping lots of stuff, but it is also fixed. Here, so this is the thing I want to mention. I don't hit any leg. So it is still positive. I am still increasing the water level, but not as much as the line that has occurred before. Similarly here, it is still increasing, but it is a very small increase because it is only the thin trunk here as opposed to the thick torso. And by the way, an off-topic alert here, there is a paper that uses this derivative graphs to recognize and reconstruct shapes. It's called Deep Transform, I think. So I recommend you to check that out, but it has nothing to do with our topic today. So this is the derivative intuition, and why I take the derivative of this energy function and set it to zero, find its roots, because of the following. So this is our function E, not the derivative graph, the function graph, maybe water level or something. So derivative is the rate of change. So there is, and the interesting points are here, local minimum, maximum or local minima. So there is no change at all in this E value. See, if I go slightly left or right, I will still end up with the same E value. So it hints for a local minima or minimum or maximum. That's why I go for derivative equal to zero. That is the intuition. And sine of derivative at this point is positive. Okay, so because the slope of this line, which is the derivative, is positive, meaning that ascent direction is towards right. Positive means go right. Then you will have an increase in your function fx or ex. Similarly, derivative is negative at this point. Yes, it is true. If you look at the derivative, it has a totally different slope than this one. So negative means go to left to increase the function value. And note that on local maxima or minima, there is no ascent at all. So maybe here, then the slope is zero. And also magnitude of derivative states how eagerly EX wants to go up or down. So if it is zero, then it doesn't want, there is no eager, it doesn't want to go up or down. It is the local minima or maxima. Now enough with the intuitions, let's do some real work. So remember, I want to minimize you this function, okay? So to do that, first fix R and find T, okay? So this is that function. So let's rewrite this. This is basically, so how do I rewrite this? First things first, I have also derived equations for you in the deformation class like this. So one little trick that we use all the time is this. The squared length of a vector from B to A or whatever for any vector can be written as A minus B transpose times that vector. So vector transpose times the vector. Why? Because I can just verify you by example here, and it generalizes well. if your a is 2, 3, 4 and b is 10, 20, 30, then the squared length is the sum of the component-wise differences, right? Sum of the squares of the component-wise differences. So like minus 8 square plus minus 17 square, etc. So do I can also get that with this tactic. So 2 minus 10, so transpose means a 1 by 3 row vector. Naturally, every point is a column vector 3 by 1, okay? And transpose will make it just horizontal, as you know. So basically, A times... So let's go over here. And, so this is B... so this will be A transpose for any vector times B is equal to is going to give me what? So let's see, it will be giving me the square of 2 minus 10, one from the row vector, one from the column vector, then square of 3 minus 20, one from the row vector, one from the column vector. So this trick, I can write it with this transpose form. Then what I do is, I apply the basic, this is a package, this is one point, and this is second point. Similarly, one point here, and second vector here, not point, vector. So this transpose times this, and this transpose times this, then this transpose times this, which is this guy, and finally plus qi transpose qi. So first things first, these two things are equal. So because it can be generalized, at transpose b is equal to bt transpose a. So this is something we can verify again. 2, 3, 4 times 10, 20. So 2 times 10, 3 times 20, 4 times 30, okay? It can also be written as 10 times 2, 20 times 3, and 30 times 4. So same result. So these two are the same. I will keep only one of them. I will get rid of this. I will keep two of this guy. So this is how I do it. This part is exactly the same. And what else? I also copy-pasted this part. So now I am at this line. So I don't want to expand all of this because eventually I will take the derivative of this function with respect to t. So I'm interested in the terms with t. So what are they? Rp transpose. If you focus on this multiplication only, Rp transpose will hit the t here. Okay. So it is there. Then what happens? T transpose will hit Rp I, which is here. And basically what just happened here? This is the same issue. I have still the ATB thing going on here, where A is equal to R times PI and B is equal to T. Then this is BT times A. So I can just keep one of them. I will keep this. So this is basically, I will just keep 2 times T transpose RPI. And there is also one thing missing, T transpose times T, which is... where it is, okay, it is also here. So eventually, and then what are the t terms? I am done with here. From here, I have no t term here. I won't do it. But here I have one t term, minus 2 t transpose times minus 2 t transpose times qi. Now let's keep everything together by taking the derivatives with respect to t. So what happens? This guy, t derivative with respect to t goes away and I have 2 rpi. Wonderful. This guy minus t minus 2 t t qi, so t goes away minus qi. It is also welcome. And also this guy, it is like t squared, because it is the length of t squared. It is like t squared, the derivative will be 2t. So this is also here. And again, if you, let's just do it for a second. The derivative of t transpose times t is equal to 2t. It is clear, but let me derive it quickly. Basically, this is, if you write this, this is the length of t or a vector, let's call it a, not t. Length of a vector, squared length, so there is no square root. It is a0 square plus a1 square plus a2 square. I need to take partial derivatives with respect to a. So this becomes 2a0 for with respect to a0 component. With respect to a1 component, the partial derivative will be 2a1 and 0 of all others, etc. So, and this part is equal to 2 times the original a. Hence, I have 2t here. So let's go further. I need to set this to 0, okay? So 0 is equal to, again, get rid of the terms without I. So 2r, I can put it in front of the I summation. Within that, I need to keep wi and pi, which is here, wonderful. Then what happens? 2 and t doesn't depend on I. It is outside, but I will keep the sum. And for this, minus 2 doesn't depend on I outside. And inside, I have wi times qi. Then, remember, I need to find t. So leave t alone. 2t times this thing is equal to, this becomes plus 2, this thing, minus 2r summation. Divide everything by 2. So 2s are just going out of my life easily. Then divide everything by the sum of all the weights. So then this becomes 1. Gets out of my life. What is happening here? Let's for a second assume all the weights are 1. Then it, what is this value? It is the sum of 1s and n many 1s. So basically n. It is the number of points, right? I will divide qi with the number of points. In other words, I will divide the sum of all points with the number of points. So this is the average point. This is the average. This is the center of all the qi's. And when weight is not 1, it is the weighted center. But essentially, if all your pi's are like this, then this, when I divide it by the sum of all weights, I will end up with the center, weighted center of all these points. And I will call it Q hat or Q bar, whatever. Then, similarly, minus R is fixed times Pi. So this is the answer, basically. I computed it. The optimal translation is a vector from the rotated center of P in motion to the fixed center of Q. I also need to find rotation. So, plug the optimal t in the e. Basically, I will, so the optimal t, now in this configuration, I will find the r. So, if you plug the optimal t, which is what, remember, what was the optimal t? Q bar minus rp bar. So, if I plug q bar minus rp bar here, and everything is the same, I will just rearrange terms with r parentheses, okay, r something minus something. So what is this something? It is the mean shifted coordinates of pi, because I extract mean from all the coordinates. So let's call it xi, let's call this yi. This is the mean shifted version of q points, the fixed points. So now I have a clear representation. I want to minimize this function by going through the r's. Let's rewrite this. It ends up like this from the transpose trick. Now, this is, this term is transpose. What is it? It is R X I transpose. And a transpose identity is, I can write this AB transpose is equal to BT times AT, right? So this identity is happening here. So let's write it like that. This and keep this the same. So I just rewrite that equation with that identity of AB transpose is equal to BT times AT. Then what is happening? If I multiply this with this, I have this. Then I will multiply this term with this term. So minus this thing times yi. Then minus yi transpose rxi, which is here. And then plus yi transpose yit, which is here. One incredible observation. Rt times r is just identity. Why? Because r is an orthogonal matrix. Rotation matrices are orthogonal. So it means that the transpose of a rotation matrix is equal to its inverse. That's why if you multiply Rt with r, you will end up with identity. So basically this term is then xitx over. What is these two terms? So we have what is happening here? X, this is okay, so this term is basically equal to yit rx, and I have two of them, so two of them, it is similar to our atb equal to bta argument, and then I have this thing. Now another tricky observation. I want to minimize this function. To minimize this function, basically I need to maximize this function, right? Because it is the negative term. If I maximize it, then the overall function will minimize because these are positive terms. So I need to increase the negative term. So all my problem boils down to this part. Maximize this function. Okay, so far so good. So to get rid of these summations, I will just use big vectors, bit matrices. So basically, I will put all the y points, the mean shifted q points, as rows to this long matrix, and similarly as columns to this x matrix. So I have, and to get the sum, I will do the trace over this. So the problem is to maximize this trace, okay, where r is the variable and all others are fixed. So a trace identity, trace AB is equal to trace BA. So I can, if this is the A and this is the B, I can just rewrite so that r is isolated in the beginning, rx wyt. So this is a matrix, obviously. I can do an SVD decomposition on that because every matrix can be decomposed into a rotation, a non-uniform scaling, and another rotation. So what I mean is the following. Here is a matrix, it's a linear operator, it will move these vectors by a motion. I will end up with this. But I can decompose this from this perspective. I will rotate it, okay, which is V. I will non-uniform scale it by sigma, see. And then I will rotate it slightly more with U. So any matrix can be first apply V rotation, then apply sigma non-uniform scaling, then apply U. Any matrix can be decomposed like this. So let's also decompose it. So I have R times this decomposition. Again, do that trace tactic. So this is going to the beginning and this is going to the end, because I want to isolate the non-rotation matrix, which is the non-uniform scaling matrix. So a trick here, this is a matrix, but this is an orthogonal matrix because all V, R and U, they are all rotation matrices. By the definition, these are rotations and R is already rotation that I'm looking for. And so this matrix that I call M, which is equal to VT times R times U, it is orthogonal. What does it mean? The columns of me, M, are orthonormal. So they have unit length, but more importantly, to get that unit length, all entries must be less than one, okay? All entries must be less than one, so keep that in mind. Remember, I want to maximize this function. So sigma is a diagonal non-uniform scaling matrix. So it has small sigma 1, small sigma 2, small sigma 3. And these are positive scaling factors in different directions. So this is sigma 2, this is sigma 1, this is sigma 0, etc. So I will hit this matrix with an orthonormal matrix, and every column there will be entries that will have a length of 1. So if I put 0.7 here, then I will get only 0.7 out of this sigma 0. But I can do better. I can put 1 here, then I will get all of this positive term. Similarly, I will put 1 here to get all of this positive term. And similarly, I will put 1 here to get all this positive term. So it implies that M has to be the identity matrix. So this is the critical observation. Then everything is easy. M is identity, which is equal to VT times R times U. So multiply both sides by V. I have V times identity. V times VT is identity because just we have seen here orthogonal matrices. Here multiplication is identity. Is RU. So V is RU. So what is R? Basically, I will multiply both sides by UT. So UUT cancels here, and V is partnered up with UT. So this is the result. R is equal to V times UT. And basically V is based on X and Y, and X and Y are based on P and Q. So everything is in its place now. Okay, so that was the most technical part of today's class. The rest is fairly more straightforward. ICP, so assume closest point correspondence. Remember, I don't know which points are corresponding, so assume closest points are in correspondence. So with that PIQI matching, I will do one shot of this T and R computation, then I will apply that T and R, and I will end up with this configuration. Then I will reselect the closest point correspondences, and they will be better. Just look at here. So previously this point, I think it was like this, it corresponds to this point, which is not really true, but even at the second iteration it comes close to the ground truth correspondence. So the R and T will be even better in the next iteration. Yeah, so I like this GIF a lot. So it describes the process better than words. Yeah, so it goes like that. And the original ICP paper is named this. It's a 1992 thing. Again, this is the mostly cited paper to my knowledge. Obviously, there are some tweaks to this algorithm, like you can do sampling. Don't use all the points, but some sample points. You can use KD trees for closed point searches. And also, point-to-point distance can also be replaced by point-to-plane distances. So this is what I mean here. So normally I have done this point-to-point distance, but I can also do point-to-plane distance. So assume that I have plane information, normal information, then I can take the... okay, so for P, instead of using this distance, I can use this distance, which is basically the dot product of the vector from Q to P to the normal of this Q. Okay, remember dot product is the length of the projection of this over here, and this is exactly the distance that I want here. So it is more accurate, it slides through the planar regions fastly, so it has a faster performance rate. So actually I have a video apparently on that, so let me show you the comparison here. Point to point iterations are still in action, but point to plane has already finished. Okay, so this is one thing. And by the way, point to plane, I can also derive this. It has already been driven. So let me talk about it a little bit. So this is the vector from the qi to the transform point, okay, basically this thing, the orange vector, and I want to dot it onto this ni, which is this. So it is kind of difficult to solve this because I have n also in action, but the idea is the following. If you assume small rotations, like theta is close to zero, then cos theta or cos alpha becomes one, because when alpha is zero, it is one, right? Similarly, sin alpha becomes zero. So when alpha is zero, I can get rid of these trigonometric identities. I can directly use alpha or ones. So this is rotation around x-axis, but if you do it for the general case, the rotation matrix becomes this, free of your cosines, etc. Then the rest is easy. He just expands this equation by replacing R with this matrix, okay? So that equation boils down to this one. Then it can be rewritten by merging pi minus qi stuff, which exists at every row. So this is the cross product part, and this is the dot product. Remember, c can be computed by cross product, and okay, so this is the R. I can put all alpha, beta, and gamma responsible for rotation into this R column vector, and this can be dotted with this part. So this part is the cross product between P and N, as you may notice. So then this function becomes this, and then it is more clear to rewrite this. You will take the derivatives with respect to all the partial derivatives with respect to all the unknowns, like rotation factors as well as translations, and you will be solving a system. So the reason it works is because of that. When alpha is, so I want to mention this linearization of rotations one more time with a picture. When the rotation angle is small, like the blue line here, the line also represents the rotation perfectly. But as I go higher and higher, so at this point, for instance, the length should have been only from here to here, because I am rotating through the circle. However, if I go with the linearization, the length, there will be an excessive amount here, so that error increases. But it is not a big deal when the rotation amount from the x-axis is small, so that's the intuition. Okay, going on. Okay, so this is still about point-to-plane metric. Again, instead of using this distance, I will be using distance from point to the plane of this black point. Okay, so in theory, in practice, people use a combination where the point-to-plane distance is dominated, but still point-to-point distance is also taken into consideration. And so this is just one example. Again, the motivation is from one view of a scan, there are some points that the other view doesn't see. So in this case, for instance, this view doesn't see this part, but this view does. So when you combine them up, you fill that region. So it is the idea. And if I reiterate, you sample some points, don't work with all the points, match the closest points, point-wise match, so it will be assigned the points based on the closest points. Then if that assignment is due to a very long distance, don't consider that point at all. Then minimize this function that we have derived using SVD, or actually there is also another way to minimize it. Yes, okay, here to minimize that function, Rotation can also be computed based on quaternions, etc. Actually, it is done in the original paper, but I found the SVD-based minimization derivation more clear to me, so I talked about that, but it is as effective as that one. Okay, so yeah, minimize that. Now let's talk about more tricks. Random sampling, which is suggested here, can be improved slightly if I get by getting diversity of normals. So what I mean is have equal number of points for each possible normal. So for instance, if I sample the points, there will be many points here, right? Because there is a very small area in this part. And if I do it like that, then this part will dominate. So if I have many, many points on this horizontalish part, then the energy function will be almost zero because the effect of these places will be very small. They will vanish. But what I suggest is have equal number of points for each normal. So for this abnormal, I have 3 points, and I have a right normal, I will also have 3 points sampled here. So this is not uniform sampling, but this is very effective. Then I will give as much importance to this region as I do to this region. Yeah, so it is a useful trick. Other tricks are you can improve your correspondences. Goal is to identify when 2 points on different scans represent the same feature. So I am going with the closest points, but I can also check the surrounding similarity. And for that, there are many descriptors like shape histograms. Put some sectors around this point. In 2D, there will be area. In 3D, there will be volumes. So take the volume sum or area sum, landing into each of these histogram bins. Okay, then compare the points. Or other than that, there are really many other descriptors that I have talked about in our distances sampling and descriptors class early in the semester. Shape diameter function, again, it's you send rays from one point to the other points and take the lengths of these rays. So send rays in the opposite direction of normals with a cone. So in thick regions, this sum will be high, so I can have thick regions with high points, but in thin regions, those rays will be very short. But all of these actions are costly, okay? So you need to keep that in mind. Do not match two close points. Even if they are closed, don't match them if their normals are too different, because they will probably be incompatible then. Do not match two close points if they are on the boundaries, because the boundaries, they have nowhere to go other than this little point. That's why they are not so trustworthy. Also, do not match two close points if the closeness is not satisfactory. So I mean, okay, so these, they are close by this distance, okay, but these two are close by a distance that is more than the average of all the pairwise distances, more than twice the average of the pairwise distances, then discard that match. Okay, enough with the ICP. Let's also talk about RANSAC, which is also very important, random sample consensus. Effectively, ICP only needs 3 point pairs to define a rotation in 3D, right? And in 2D, only 2 points. So brute force, I can solve this problem. Try all triplets in one shape, which is n plus 3, a cubic complexity. So for the current trial, and I will also set a base triplet on the other shape. This is fixed. And all these n plus 3 will be tested with that base triplet, do the rotation and translation by the SVD-based derivation I have shown you. If they are not compatible, the base and any of these guys, then you will not get a very small error. So then try a different base, say L different bases. So the complexity will be L times n cube. Again, what is this L is an issue. Also, n cube is too much. So this is the brute force solution. And actually, to do the optimal, you need also to try all the bases, which is another m cubes tree. If I have m points on the other shape, Ransak builds on this idea. Pick a random 3 points on 2 shapes. Estimate the transformation in the least square sense. Then check out the error for this alignment. So for this, I think orange to orange, green to green, this color to this color, it has, so the error here is too many, right? So it's not okay. For a different triplet, this is the error. For a different triplet, this is the error. So finally, out of all these trials, keep the one with the minimum error. Random picks do not and are not likely to be perfect matches, so you will end up with this configuration. The good news is this can be a good start for your ICP then, because the main point of ICP is, I forgot to mention this, but it depends on the initialization. With a good initialization, ICP performs wonderfully. So if I look at our animation here, so this is supposed to be a good initialization, the orange, so at the beginning, not here, but here, okay. This is a satisfactory initialization. So Ransak may help you to pick a good initialization. Or if you are lucky enough, or if you have enough time, you can also do everything with Ransak. And so this is also talking about the same thing. And this is the end of today's class. As usual, I will point you to some potential project topics like ICP under noise or outliers. Also, non-rigid ICP, so it's a challenging thing, but I narrowed this down for you. You may look at this section in this paper to get things started for the non-rigid ICP. But regardless, ICP was the heart of today's class, and I hope that it has landed well. Yeah, thanks.